There's a soft cotton dress on the line hanging dry. The window's wide open. African trees bent over backwards in a hurricane breeze. Not a word of goodbye, not even no. She's gone with the man in the long black coat. Somebody seen him hanging around at the old dance hall on the outskirts of town. Him to ask if you wanted to dance. You had a face like a mask. Somebody said from the Bible he quoted, there was dust on the man in the long black coat.
Welcome to British Audiophile and a new series in which I'm going to deal with common myths and misconceptions in hi-fi. Try and say that when you've had a couple of pints of beer. And this series is going to start with an episode on speaker setup, which has been inspired by a couple of recent experiences which I'd like to share with you. So about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I went down to a dealer who had just finished demoing a £17,000 pair of speakers, one of my favourite brands, to a customer who had a similar price speaker but wasn't quite happy with the tonality of that and was looking to change. They were kind enough to invite me in and allow me to have a listen, of course, after the customer had left. And I had a listen, and I know these speakers really well, and I know that they are capable of some remarkable things in the right setup in the right room. But on this particular occasion, there was a significant resonance around the 60 to 80 hertz range, and I politely pointed this out to the customer. And they said, yeah, no, we know, we're aware, it's a new listening room and we're going to be putting in some acoustic treatment. Now, dealing with resonances at 60 to 80 hertz is no small feat. You have to put in some significant amount of bass treatment, and there, you know, that's kind of some heavy, thick acoustic paneling. But if I had listened to those pair of speakers in that particular room, and that's the only experience I would have had, I personally wouldn't have bought them. And it would have been no fault of the manufacturer or the speaker, just purely the fact that they didn't sound particularly good in that room. Now, I've just come back from the Bristol Hi-Fi show here in the UK. That was on at the weekend. And hi-fi shows are really my opportunity to go and have a chat with manufacturers. I'm not in the industry anymore, so I can go and speak to manufacturers. And it's more the conversations that I have about trends and what's going on really in the industry that's of appeal to me, and also what's new and interesting. I know that I really can't make any real judgments about how a system sounds listening to them in a hi-fi show. But I've got 30 years of experience in this industry, friends still in the industry. I've got an engineering and science background. I'm not trying to blow smoke up my own backside, but I think I have a reasonable understanding of the rudimentaries of how to put together a decent hi-fi system. There's a large, significant number of people who come to those shows who don't have that level of experience and expertise. And that's their opportunity to really get their eyes and ears on a pair of speakers or amplifier or whatever that they're really interested in. And they're going to make judgments about what that sounds like. Now, room after room that we came in, the sound was disappointing. And I understand it, manufacturers have to demo their latest gear, but essentially, the vast majority of rooms out there were bedrooms. The furniture had been pulled out and they plonked their latest, let's say, flagship floor standing speaker in a small bedroom. Now, there's nothing you can do to make that sound good. That room is being overloaded by that speaker. exciting resonances, they're playing them at loud levels, and they sound quite off, quite frankly awful in a lot of those cases. So we went into, I'd say probably 80% of the rooms out there had speakers that were too big, too loud in a relatively small room, sounding boomy and bloated. Couple of examples, there was a £200,000 amplifier hooked up to £30,000 worth of speakers in a room which had very little furnishings, had a glass wall all the way pretty much down one side onto an atrium, sounded absolutely awful. And there was another room which had softer furnishings, it was carpeted, it was a large room, and had Audio Lab 6000 amplifier with its streamer, which I think is about £450, hooked up to the new Wharfdale, I think it's called the Evo 4s, which are £1,000. It's about a £2,000 system, which sounded fantastic. If I was new to this hobby and I was walking in and I listened to that room at £2,000 and another one at £250,000, and the £2,000 room sounded better than the £250,000 room, what conclusions am I going to make about this industry and what is going on? And this is what breeds that kind of feeling that this industry is full of snake oil and charlatans. And it isn't. Manufacturers, there's genuine improvements as you go up in price, but people don't really understand the significance that the room has to play. It's by far the most significant aspect of how a system sounds, and choosing the right speaker for your room in terms of tonality, choosing the right speaker in your room in terms of how it loads the room, especially at low frequencies, is critical if you're going to get a good sound. You can get a £2,000 system to sound better than a £250,000 system if you set it up right. Now that might sound like a load of BS, but I can tell you from direct experience of this weekend that that is the case, and I had a friend with me who would confirm it as well. So rant over, let's get on to speaker setup and how you position your speakers in a room. Now, before people start wading in with comments, I'm not trying to say that a £250,000 system doesn't sound better than a £2,000 system. Of course it does. As you spend more money, you should get better sound. What I'm saying is that a well set up £2,000 system can sound better than a poorly set up £250,000 system. So if the room is so important, it's really beneficial to have some understanding of how your loudspeaker interacts in the room in terms of acoustics. And I did a whole series of videos on the basics of putting together a hi-fi system, and the first few episodes were all about choosing a speaker that had the right tonal balance and the right dynamic output for your room. And if you're interested in that, perhaps check out that series. But those of you who are interested in the science and real detail, Dr. Floyd Toole literally wrote the book on loudspeaker design and room acoustics. He led the research for about 20 years in the 80s and 90s in terms of how a speaker interacts in the room. And this is called Sound Reproduction, the Acoustics and Psychoacoustics of Loudspeakers and Rooms. And it's not an easy read. It's full of the science and technology that they employed, but worth checking out nonetheless. Acoustics and some basic do's and don'ts. If you've got an acoustically lively space, now that's a space where you may have hardwood floors, minimal soft furnishings, big large windows, it's best to avoid speakers that have an overly bright or extended treble response, high frequency extension. All that they're going to do is excite resonances high up the frequency range where they're very audible and they sound brittle and hard. Now, typical brands would be Focal and B&W. They work much better in acoustically less lively spaces. Now, getting the right size of speaker for your room is also really important. I spoke about this in that earlier series of videos that I did about the basics of putting together a hi-fi system. You can put a small speaker in a large room and add subwoofers, but That will give you bass extension. What it won't give you is dynamics further up the range. It'll always sound like that speaker system is slightly compressed. You're not going to get an effortless, engaging, dynamic sound. There's no getting around the physics of it. Sound waves pressurize a room. Sound pressure that our ears effectively detect. Now, what's more common as a problem is people putting large speakers in a relatively small room. Small rooms have problems in terms of resonances at low frequencies. And by the very nature of a large speaker, what it does is not only does it play louder, but it also goes deeper in terms of its bass response than its kind of small monitor sibling. So big speakers have more dynamic output, they play louder, but they also have more bass extension. That's what I'm basically saying. And by having a large speaker, you're going to have more energy at those low frequencies, exciting the room resonances to a greater extent, and that results in a boomy, overbloated sound. So get the right size of speaker for your room. So if you followed that advice and you've picked a loudspeaker in terms of its high frequency extension that works well in the room that you have acoustically, and the right size of speaker so dynamically it loads the room correctly and avoids in particular the energy at low levels that excites bass resonances, you've dodged a bullet. You've avoided the first hurdle that most people fall at, which is in terms of tonality and dynamics, getting your system to sound right. Now, a little note here about judging speakers based on the type of tweeter that they employ. You hear it all the time, people saying, well, I don't like metal dome tweeters, they're too bright. I don't like soft dome tweeters, they're too rolled off. And making a judgment about a tweeter based on the material it's used is misleading. There are soft dome tweeters that extend up to 25,000-30,000 kilohertz and sound bright, and there are metal dome tweeters that sound rolled off. It's not about the type of material, it's about the design and the implementation. You have to look a lot deeper than just purely the material employed. An example of that is I have PSB Imagine Minis. They're metal dome tweeters, they're not rolled off. Harbaths use metal dome tweeters. You can accuse them being a lot of things, but one thing you can't accuse them of is being bright. So we're going to talk about room setup and speaker positioning, and I'm going to start with symmetry. Symmetry is your friend. Now, what do I mean by symmetry? I'm sat here in the listening position. Normally I'd be turned around, and what I'm trying to do is create a triangle between myself and those two speakers. And if I place myself at the apex of the triangle, what I'm trying to do is achieve same kind of acoustic symmetry that I have on the left-hand side of the room than I have on the right-hand side of the room. Well, how do you achieve that? You achieve that by maintaining the same distance from the walls surrounding the speaker. So if you look at that speaker there, it has the same distance pretty much to the side wall as that speaker does. They also similar distance from the fireplace, almost identical distance from the fireplace, and identical distance from the speaker to the wall behind them. Why is that important? Well, that loudspeaker is loading the entire room with sound, but fundamentally most of the energy is concentrated on the left-hand side, and that speaker is similarly loading the entire room with sound energy, but the energy is fundamentally concentrated on the right-hand side. The higher energy levels are higher the closer you get to the speaker, and what you want is the loading on the left-hand side of the room to be very similar to the loading on the right-hand side of the room. If that isn't the case, you're going to get very inconsistent results. Some tracks are going to sound good and some tracks are going to sound awful, depending on what kind of rooms or resonances are excited at what frequencies and what kind of musical content is being produced. So symmetry, as I said at the beginning, is your friend. So how far can I get away with pulling my speakers into the room, and what's the minimum distance they need to be from the walls? Well, this is really about understanding how your speaker interacts with the room at low frequencies. Effectively, moving your speakers in and out away from walls is like a bass control. Your speaker produces bass energy fairly evenly around it in all directions. Bass frequencies are omnidirectional because the wavelengths are so big compared to the size of the speaker. By placing your speaker closer to the wall, more of the energy is reflected off the wall and forwards. That's why speakers sound more bassy the closer you put them to the wall. Conversely, as you move them further and further out, you'll see that bass energy drops off. There is a minimum distance you need to maintain. Now, I measure from the tweeter, so I get a measuring tape. I take the tweeter, the front of the speaker where the tweeter is positioned, and I measure from there, and I maintain a distance of minimum of 85 centimeters, that's just under 3 feet, from the wall behind it and the wall at the side. And there's a reason scientifically for that. And the reason is that any sound that hits your ear from a reflected surface that isn't delayed by 5 milliseconds is perceived as direct sound. Now, speed of sound in air under normal atmospheric conditions is 340 meters a second. That's 34 centimeters, just over a foot per millisecond. So to create a delay, which is what we're trying to do from those reflected surfaces of a minimum of 5 milliseconds, you need 1.7, 1.8 meters or just under 6 feet. It's half that distance that you need. So 3 feet or, you know, 85 centimeters is the minimum because it's bouncing off there and coming back. By doing that, you've created a 5 millisecond delay from those early reflected surfaces. Having it closer means that your ears perceive, as I say, that reflected sound as direct sound. That messes with stereo imaging and it masks transients, so they're not so clearly defined leading edges of notes and they're slightly more muffled. That's really important. Now, what do? I pick a track that I know well that has natural, good, varied bass. So Miles Davis, Kind of Blue album, Dave Brubeck, Take Five. The reason is there's only four instruments that's playing. So it's really easy for me to isolate the double bass and the drums. And I'm only listening to those two instruments. And what I'm listening for is tonality and richness and variation in tone. How clearly defined they are. Can I separate out different instruments? I plonk it. My speaker's at that position, 85 centimeters from the wall, and I say it's measuring from the tweeter. And I listen in my listening position. And then if I'm happy with them, and I do exactly the same with a measuring tape for the left and the right speaker, so they're exactly acoustically symmetrical. And then I move them out 15 centimeters and listen again. Is it better or is it worse? If it's better, I leave them in that position. If it's worse, I move them back. And eventually you'll fine-tune this to the point where you're only moving your speakers 1 or 2 centimeters, an inch or two in old money, so that you've got the bass response just right. But as I say, choose something that's well recorded, choose something that you know well, choose something that's got a natural bass so you can pick up on tonality. We instinctively probably know better what a double bass should sound like and what drums should sound like than synthetic electronically produced instruments. If you follow those kind of rules, you'll get the bass response right. So how far apart should the speakers be away from each other? What should be the distance between the two speakers? Well, that depends on the size of your room. The bigger your room, the further apart your speakers are likely to be. Most people will find their speakers to be either 2 to 4 meters apart. These are slightly closer, they're 1.8 meters apart. That's because I have them in a midfield listening setup, and I'll explain why later on. And what you're listening for in terms of how far they should be apart or how close they should be together is how well defined the center image is. Now, the central image is normally the lead instrument or lead vocal. Could be a guitar, could be a male or female vocal, and you're listening for how well defined that is. If you close your eyes, a well defined center image, you should be able to almost reach out and touch the central performer. If the speakers are too far apart, that center image is going to be a little more vague and hazy, and you're not going to be quite so sure when you close your eyes as to where that sound is coming from. If you move your speakers too close together, also, the sound stage reduces in terms of scale. So there's a balance here. You need to have them far enough apart to maintain a decent wide sound stage, but close enough together so that that center image is locked in. Get the balance between those two right, you've got the right distance between your two speakers. What's the effect of towing in your speakers? What I mean by towing in your speakers is turning them inwards so that the tweeter is pointing more directly towards your ears. Well, if moving your speakers away from walls acts as a bass control, towing them in acts as a treble control. And the reason is that high frequencies have a short wavelength and are much more direct and act much more like a laser beam in terms of their dispersion characteristic. So by towing them in, you're getting much more energy from the tweeter, direct sound from the tweeter, than you are if you're moving slightly off axis. And we know this by standing in front of your speaker. If you place your ear close to the tweeter, you'll hear the high frequencies much more pronounced than you would if you walked around the back of it. So towing in your speaker acts like a treble control, but will also have some bearing on how well defined that center image is. By turning your speakers inwards, you're directing more energy towards the center. It's a bit like moving your speakers closer together. You'll notice the central image will become more defined at the expense of soundstage width. So once you've got your speakers set up and you tow them in, you might find that you need to do some fine tuning, maybe move them slightly further apart again in order to get the balance right between center image and soundstage width. So how far apart should I be from my speakers if my speakers are, say, 2 meters apart? Well, depending on where you go and who you listen to, you'll get very different advice. I think most people listen too far away from their speakers and would be better off and will get better sound if they were much closer to their speakers. So I maintain a distance of about 1 to 1. So if the speakers are 2 meters apart, I'm a similar distance away from those speakers. And the reason is, the closer you get to your speakers, the more direct sound you hear from your speakers and less reverberant sound from the room. So you're taking the room out of play by getting close to the speakers. Now, there are limits in terms of how close you can get to a speaker, and that depends on its size and its design. Smaller speakers you can get closer to than bigger speakers, and the reason is that bigger speakers have more drivers, the tweeter, the mid-range, the woofer, and they each have their acoustic center which are further apart. Big speakers are designed to sound cohesive, so you get good driver integration at further distances. Smaller speakers are designed to work in smaller rooms. The acoustic center between the tweeter and perhaps the mid-bass woofer, if it's a two-way design, is much closer, and you can get much closer to those speakers without experiencing problems with driver integration. You know, when you've got too close to speaker, the tweeter will start sounding harsh and bright. You move your head a few inches this way and that way, and the tonality of the speaker changes. Okay, so we're getting to the end of this video, and there's just a few tips I'd like to go through in terms of fine-tuning your speaker setup. One is the height of the speaker. The height of the speaker should be so that the acoustic center of the speaker, which is normally the tweeter, is at ear level. It's also really important to make sure that that tweeter is a minimum of 85 centimeters from the floor. We spoke about this earlier. By doing that, what you do is you delay that early reflection by the critical 5 milliseconds that we need, so it doesn't really mess around with stereo imaging and transient response. The only thing I'd place on the floor is a rug. That's really helpful because what it does is it absorbs a lot of the high frequency and mid frequency energy off that floor, which is really audible in your listening position where you're sat in front of the speakers. And that's the only thing I'd place in front of a speaker. Someone I know very well had a very expensive pair of speakers and then decided later on to place a large dining table between himself and the speakers. It's fair to say that the dining table is still there, but the speakers are gone. And other people put coffee tables, glass coffee tables, in front of them. Well, that's going to cause all kinds of problems with reflections and messing around with the sound. So what else is worth mentioning? Well, in a lot of cases, it's beneficial to rake your speaker slightly backwards, tilt it upwards if you like. And what that does is it lifts the soundstage to make it sound more natural. I've done that with the Proax behind me. And if you've got bookshelf monitor speakers, it's worthwhile investing in some decent stands and filling those stands, if you have the opportunity to do, with sand or cat litter so that you dampen down resonances. If you've got bookshelf or floor standing speakers, in the vast majority of the cases, I would decouple them from the floor with some kind of anti-vibration material. You don't have to spend a fortune. There's stuff that's designed for washing machines, mats and stuff like that, that basically work quite well. And what that does is it stops the floor from being excited and resonating. The only time I would use spikes is if I had a concrete floor, because a concrete floor is that heavy and that inert that it's very little resonant energy in those cases, and that way I would probably directly couple my speaker to that floor. So if you haven't got a concrete floor, you're better off dampening your speaker with some kind of material. Hopefully you got something from this video in terms of how to set up a pair of speakers in a room. If you like this video, please consider hitting the like button. If you like my approach to hi-fi, please consider subscribing if you haven't done so already. It really helps in terms of growing this channel and promoting it to a wider audience. I look forward to reading comments in the comment section of this video about your own experiences of setting up speakers and your own advice. And if you've got any ideas in terms of myth busting and misconceptions in hi-fi that you'd like me to do moving forward, I really look forward to reading those comments as well. So for today, for now, a British Audiophile signing off.